All right, let's get started. So tonight we're going to talk about, is my lifestyle killing me? If I ask most people that question, guess what the answer is?
Yeah.
No, it's not. And the reason that it's not is because we compare ourselves to other people. The only problem with that is we live in the sickest population of human beings on the face of planet Earth that you don't go to the bathroom outside. Did you realize that? You live in the sickest place in the world. It's almost like if you were a cancer patient and you were in a cancer ward and you're doing better than the other cancer patients and you go, hey, I'm pretty healthy in here, right? You're a cancer patient in a cancer ward. You're not healthy. If you live a lifestyle like everybody else around you, guess what? It's an unhealthy lifestyle. I don't care how much salads you eat or if you own a gym membership, it doesn't work out for you in the end. You have to do something different. Does that make sense? So the whole workshop today is going to be about lifestyle. Everybody say lifestyle.
Lifestyle.
Say it again, lifestyle.
Lifestyle.
It's not about trying to get a problem and then get a solution for the problem. It's about lifestyle. For instance, my wife and I just got back from our vacation. Thank you guys for being patient with us being gone. It was an awesome vacation, by the way. We had a blast. But we're on vacation, and we rented a house on a hill in the middle of nowhere, by the way. And this house was like 500 feet up. You could see like 40 miles. It was beautiful. But it was on a paved road that went literally 45-degree incline like this. Like, you didn't know if you were going to be able to drive up it. And so we were the first ones out of the house, and we jogged down this hill, and then we ran sprints up this thing. And then we would jog down, and we'd run sprints back up, and then we would jog down, and we'd run sprints back up. Every time we were up, it was like this. Like this. Why would we do that? Why would I even exercise on vacation? And the reason is because it's our lifestyle. That's our lifestyle. We are people that exercise. We don't exercise so that we have abs. We don't exercise so that we've got big muscles or something. We exercise because that's our lifestyle. That's what's healthy. That's what's kept us healthy. And that's what I want you to be thinking about tonight, right? So it's not about I have a problem and I need a solution for that problem. Your problem lies in your lifestyle that you currently have. Does that make sense? Like, so many people will come in, we'll do a consult with them, and I'll go in and I'll go, so let's talk about your diet. Well, that diet's pretty good. And then we get into it, and guess what? It's not as good as they thought. Well, I do have some, if I'm honest. And I'm like, are you exercising? Yep. And I start really breaking it down, and guess how often they're exercising? Not as often, maybe once a week, twice a week, and then it's never out of breath. It's just maybe lifting some weights or something, right? Again, if I really dive into your lifestyle, is it successful? So let's go through a couple things. How do you feel most days? Do you feel like you're killing it, or do you feel like it's this guy, right? Like, and again, when it comes to health, you want to be the first guy. And most people would, even to some degree, think that they're like the first guy some of the time. I would suggest most of you guys are realists enough to know that, hey, listen, I'm the second guy oftentimes because I'm tired, I've got the fatigue, I get a little brain fog, I get the afternoon. Anybody get the afternoon kind of brain fog? Anybody? You're like,
yes.
Start looking for a little something or like some calories or some caffeine or something to get you going again. Am I the only one sometimes? Right, so this is like an honesty club. All right, so how do we get you out of that? Well, if you're like most, it is killing you. And I want you to listen, it's not to speak bad stuff, whatever else. I just want to be a realist for a second. Listen, I see more patients than most doctors you've seen your whole life combined. And we sit down and do consults with people constantly. Let me tell you something. Lifestyle is the thing. Got it? It is the thing. And I'm going to talk about a lot today. I want you to go a lot away with a lot in your wheelbarrow tonight. But don't be nervous. We're going to go through the five essentials, but it's interesting when we start talking about going through five essentials, people look like this, are like, am I going to have to eat bark from now on? Is that my lifestyle from now on? I can't have anything chocolate that tastes bark. Good. Yeah, chocolate bark. Although there is a recipe for chocolate bark.
That's right.
But we're going to go through these. Okay, now we're going to start with your mindset. Mindset's most important here. It's the why you're doing things. Okay, now let me be clear. Why you're doing something is more important than how or what. Does that make sense? Why? I had a lady come in one time. She got a consult, and she said, I want to lose some weight. And I said, well, great. So why do you want to lose weight? And she goes, well, I just don't feel good. My clothes don't feel good. My joints, I think it's probably hard on my joints. I don't know if I'll live as long as I should. I was like, okay, that's a good reason, but I don't think it's big enough. Because when you really want something, it's not going to be a big enough why. And she looked at me like, no, I really want to lose weight. I go, no, I believe you. but that's not a good enough why to get you through Haagen-Dazs. That's not a big enough why to get you through popcorn and a Coke at the movies to say no to. That's not a big enough why for most things. And she started to think about it for a while. I said, why don't you just sit in there for a little bit? I'll come back. And so I left her in there 15 minutes. And I came back and I go, so give me something bigger than that. She goes, I want to be around for my grandkids to walk them down the aisle or to be at their wedding or whatever, right? And I go, now that's a big enough why, right? And then she started getting into, I want to be able to, because she was so unhealthy, she couldn't even take her grandkids to the park. Like she literally physically could not take them to the park. Now imagine what that feels like, not to be able to even go to the park with your grandkids. Now she was thinking about, what, I want to go to the park with them. I want to actually be at their weddings. Do you see where I'm going? Mm-hmm. So guess what? She's tried to lose weight her whole life, had tried everything, nothing's worked, until she really solidified why she was doing it. And guess what? Every time she wanted the Coke and the popcorn at the movie, she said no, because guess who she was thinking about? Her grandkids, not herself. Here's the thing, you guys wouldn't crawl 2-3 feet to save yourself. But if there was a baby and that was drowning or hurting or something across the road, you'd crawl through broken glass on your hands and knees to save a kid, right? And that's the thing. We won't do certain things for ourselves that we would for other people. And sometimes you need a why bigger than you. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So we start with why. We're also going to start with a little mindset. And they sent me these graphics. But if you're like most, it's literally just a pattern. It's just a pattern. What's the pattern? Well, I work out as much as I can. I try to be as least street. So right here, raise your hand if on the way here that you got stopped at a red light and you pulled into the shortest line based on trying to get here a little faster. Raise your hand. Anybody else? Thank you. Now, for everybody else, be honest now. Raise your hand. Good. No. But honestly, who here actually sped over the speed limit at least once getting here tonight? Right? Come in, SWAT. You got him. We got him on camera. But the point is, we stay stressed. What's the pattern? I'm in a hurry. I'm in a rush, right? And then I try to get something in for me, especially if you're ladies, which never ends with you. It's always your kids and your family and your friends and your house and your church and whatever else. And so what ends up happening is we, and guys, we do it too to some degree, but what ends up happening is we rush. We have great intentions to work out. We have great intentions to eat right. In fact, when we can't, we try to make better bad decisions, but we end up in the deep weeds and it's just a pattern. Guess what the pattern is? The pattern is, hey, I'm doing pretty good, but I'm gonna compare myself to the rest of the world around me. And if I'm eating 2-3 salads a week, if I'm getting 2-3 workouts in, I feel like, hey, I'm better than the most and I feel pretty good about myself. The problem with it is you are again, where? In the sickest population in the entire planet. And guess what that means? You have to be an absolute freak. And if you don't understand that, what it means is you will be headed down a road to a bad end, and it's just a reality. And I want to, it's not here to fear you or scare you into doing something different. I just want to give you the reality, because I'm the guy you sit down with when nobody else can help, and they've sent you on to be the oncologist and nobody can help you. Does that make sense? And so we're not going to do that. But what ends up happening is you live a life, you do what everybody else does, you get to that point where now I guess it's just your turn. I got diagnosed and I have to do this now because I have this diagnosis. And then guess what? They blame it on your age, they blame it on your genes, or they blame it on bad luck. And now it's your turn, and now off we go. It's just a pattern. Does it make sense? It's like lemmings. We just line up, and we're just one after another, just jumping over the ledge. And I see it constantly. I see people come in. Their kids are eating horrible stuff. They're never eating healthy things. They're, quote, picky eaters. And guess what you need to do? What you need to do is just eat right, do these 5 essentials the right way, and guess what? You don't have to end that way. Raise your hand if you believe that God made your body to be healthy without disease. But I'll challenge you. I have some people that go to the doctor, and the doctor says, well, do you have any history of heart disease? It may run in your family. I have people believing allergies runs in the family now, and everything, nothing. Listen, less than 2% of all disease runs in families, and those things are like Down syndrome and things like this. Yeah, whatever. So we don't want to just keep going down this egg carton line and jumping into pain. Got it? So how do we do that? We have to understand how disease develops. And listen, this is just the 5 essentials, basically looking at it a little differently, okay? Like the first one on this end. Essential 1, what is that? Being stressed. Do you realize that stress is a real thing? Have any of you been so stressed that you felt like your traps were like this? Anybody? Yeah, so you're stressed out of your, has anybody been so stressed that you had diarrhea? Just being honest, I have, right? Been so stressed you had diarrhea or digestive upset or maybe acid reflux or something like this. Stress is a real thing. Stress causes high blood pressure, changes in your cortisone pattern, changes in hormones, causes inflammation, causes joint issues, arthritis. Like, stress is a real thing. It causes disease, right? So you can't just think you can get adjusted. Now, if you get adjusted, you're more able to adapt to stress, which is awesome. But you also just can't live and create a life of stress and live in it every day and think that you're just going to get adjusted and everything's going to be fine. Does that make sense? But here's the second thing, especially for you guests that don't know it. If you've got a subluxation in your nerve supply and it's choked off, can you see how people do a lot of great things for their health, but they miss that one component? And because they don't hurt, they don't think there's a problem. And so organs end up failing, and they're, I did everything right. I remember the first time I was in practice, it was the first year of practice, and I had one of the top ophthalmologists in Dallas come in. The guy was, he was an organic eater. I think he's an owned garden and all the rest. Only did organic, he did all the right supplements. He never ate sugar his whole life. He exercised every day. He did everything completely right. And he was in my office because nobody could help him. And he was in phase four liver failure, cancer, liver cancer, phase four. And they'd send him home to die. What can you do for me? And he heard that we'd had some results and it was early in practice. And he looked at me, he goes, I just want to know. He goes, how did this happen? And all I could do is in tears look at him and go, man, you just missed one component. And guess what? Right where the nerves come off to his liver, he had a massive subluxation that choked off the life. And so his liver was just slowly what? Dying, and yet he was doing everything right. So again, it could just be that one. But how about nutrition? We're going to talk about nutrition and where did all the nutrition go, right? But things you eat now don't have as much nutrition as they used to. And then lack of oxygen. This is not just lack of exercise. Everybody do this. Bend over just a little bit and put your shoulder forward. And just come and play with me a little bit, like this. Now take a deep breath. Good. Now blow it out. Now everybody lean back in your chair. Bring your chin up just a little bit, chest up just slightly. Now take a deep breath. I felt my hair go this way when you did that. Did you feel how much deeper breath? Did you see that? Now blow it all the way out. Guess what? When you sit at your desk, if you sit at a desk, guess what you look like after about 2 hours? Fat like that. I've got a shallow depth. So again, lack of oxygen can just be throughout your day, right? And you train your body for that too, right? I'm going to go through breath here in a minute. But toxic accumulation. We live in a toxic environment. I don't have to convince anybody. Everybody knows. But I'm going to go through some things tonight that I never thought I'd have to go through in here or even thought about going through. And I'm going to go through it with you tonight. It's going to be awesome. But this is what happens. We have all these things build up, and then we have chronic disease. Got it? But I want to be very clear with every single person, all of our friends, everybody look back at the camera and wave, all of our friends on Facebook and in Zimbabwe and Australia. Hi, guys. It's so good to have you here. But I can tell you this. You were not meant for disease. You were not built for disease. Disease is not in your genes. The only way that you have disease is if you yourself create through lack or overdoing things or whatever else, but usually it's just interference in these five essentials. You yourself will create the disease. You may have a propensity for like a gene for cancer, but you can live 120 years and never have cancer. So then why, like somebody said, I did a study in, I did a longevity study and I brought it up in one of our longevity talks, that they have like identical twins, they're genetic equals. Right, and then you have one that dies of cancer in their 40s, 50s, or 60s, and the other one lives to 95. But they're genetic equals. Why is that? And it's epigenetics. There's something above genes, and it's basically lifestyle. Everybody say lifestyle.
Lifestyle.
There it is again. Okay, so let's get into it. Where have all the nutrients gone? Okay, you do not have the same amount of nutrients. Now I want you to imagine. I don't have time to go through as much as I wanted to today. Otherwise, I'd keep you here 2 hours. But I want you to imagine I have a penny in my hand. Okay, just one penny, okay? Now, in my other hand, I'm gonna put 65 pennies, okay? Now, I don't know if I can handle all 65 pennies. Do this sometimes, see how much, how that is. What this represents is, for you to get as much nutrition as in, was in spinach about 30, 35, 40 years ago, in one cup of spinach, would take you 65 cups of spinach today. 65. That's a big salad. See if you can get that from Salada. Right? You're going to have a hard time putting that. I mean, 65 cups. So one cup of spinach 30, 40 years ago had that much nutrition. Now, I think you still should eat spinach, but it doesn't have what it used to, which means what? I never got into chiropractic school because I wanted to sell a bunch of supplements. But guess what I found? I cannot get people healthy again without nutrition. And there's not nutrition in the foods that people are eating like there used to be. And so guess what? There's an absolute need for supplementation. And I hate to say it, but guess what? If you want to be healthy, you have to supplement. There's no other way around it. Everybody that's worth their salt in health today says the same thing. And the best and easiest way to do that, if you're not on it, is a men's or women's multi. And again, it took us 10 years to create a whole food non-synthetic. And guess what? If you get some of this stuff, you go, oh, I already take a multivitamin. Well, guess what? Bring it in and let us check it out. It ends in the hall of shame. And oftentimes there's so much filler in it. We just did research with another doctor, and he does all of our vitamins for us. They said that the average vitamin now has less than 1/100th of the active ingredient actually in it. So you go buy something that has like astaxanthin in it, right? Or has vitamin B's or those things in it. It has 1/100th of what it actually says. So to actually get that, you have to take 100 capsules to equal one capsule's what they're supposed says that's in it. Does it make sense? Which is why the FDA and the US government says that supplementation is a bunch of hooey and you know, don't waste your money, it just makes expensive urine and all the rest. That's because they're testing what kind of vitamins? Crappy vitamins, right? And so you won't get that here. Does that make sense? So make sure this is one I want you to get, okay? The key to nutrient absorption, and it's not vitamin D. Now, vitamin D is part of that, but there's something in vitamin D that you're not getting in a lot of things. It's probiotics. And some of you guys, well, I already take probiotics. But listen, you can get probiotics in every single grocery store, Walgreens, CVS, Walmart, at Costco, you can get it everywhere. But guess what you don't get? You don't get a probiotic with a prebiotic and FOS, which is fructooligosaccharide. It takes those three things to actually make something that actually works. And I don't have time to go completely through there, but if you don't have those three things in there, then it's a waste of time. The reason that this vitamin D is so good is it actually inoculates the gut and it helps you absorb your vitamins. Who here started taking the vitamin D a while back and is still taking it? Just raise your hand. Yeah, so most people here. What you probably noticed is, guess what happened to your bowel movements the same time you did that? They got better, didn't they? And you're like, that's weird, vitamin D and bowel movements. It probably did help, but it was actually the pre, pro, and FOS that was actually in this product. Make sense? Right? So this is part of how we help with gut absorption issues when we have kids that come in with colicky issues or malabsorption issues, or even some of the cancer patients that are trying to heal their gut, this is one of the things we use. So that's the first thing. Now, how do toxins work in this? And what you'll notice is, what do you notice from the left to the right? What's happening there? Get them bigger, right? So what you'll notice is, when your body is the toxic load or the burden is light and it's clear, your detox pathways being clear and clean, when you're exposed to something, you get rid of it fast, okay? But as we bioaccumulate, so what does that mean? We're getting more and more stuff in us, our bucket is filling up, so to speak. When we bioaccumulate toxins, we start to clog up the pathways, if you will. Does it make sense? So imagine a hose that should be this big around, and now there's only like that much in the middle left, and it's just squirting a little bit of water out the end instead of being able to just blow everything out. Make sense? Your body's awesome to get rid of toxins. The problem with it is it's so loaded down that it gets backed up and bioaccumulated, and as you do that, guess what happens to your metabolic processes? They do what? They start collapsing in, and you start having issues losing weight, and you start having all the others. Why is that? Why is it toxicity creates a weight gain? Does anybody know why? How did your body protect itself from toxins? Say it. Stores where? It stores your toxins in your fat tissue. So if my body is intelligent enough to store toxins in the fat, guess what my body doesn't want to open up? The Pandora's box that's holding all the toxins in. Does it make sense? It's a big key ha-ha right there. So then you guys become sugar burners instead of fat burners, so now you got sugar cravings all day long, worse than it ever has been, and now your detox pathways are even worse off, and you see people just spiral downhill. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Everybody with me?
Yes.
All right, here we go. Now, I have never gone through this in here, okay? What's an EMF? or an EMR, electromagnetic frequencies or radiation. And it's in everything: power saws, drills, toasters, refrigerators, these lights, electric shavers, blenders, can openers. It's everything that actually has any electricity to it. Even the plug-ins that don't even have anything plugged into it have EMFs and EMRs and all that stuff coming off of it. We are bombarded constantly from it. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. You can't see them, can't smell them, can't feel them, but they're constantly going through us all the time. If you would actually have a meter for frequency right now as compared to 50 years ago, what would you see? Oh my goodness, 50 years ago. I mean, some of you guys aren't old enough to remember when there was a time when there wasn't even beepers. Anybody? Where when someone wanted to get a hold of you, they had to actually call you at home or where you were supposed to be at. Some of you guys aren't old enough to remember when you went to Walmart, when you used to hear such and such, you have a call at the service desk. Please come to the service desk. They don't say that anymore, do they? Why? Because everybody's got their own phone, and they used to have to call you at the store. Remember? Yeah. I've called my own parents. Mom, I'm sorry, it's an emergency, right? Called you at a restaurant. Why? You know why? Because there wasn't EMFs everywhere. Now, let me be very clear. I'm only talking about this. This was not part of the talk. In fact, there are 500 offices doing this talk tonight, and this is one of the only offices, if not the only office, that's doing this part. And the reason I'm doing this is because I had a patient come in a lot like some of you guys here, never misses a visit, does everything right, came in, and he missed like 4 weeks in a row. I go, man, where's Scott at? And it turns out he comes in and he's got a scar, I'm gonna show you here in a minute, where they cut him from his ear down the front, down the side, down his neck right here, and they just filleted him open and they had to take out his parotid gland because he's a firefighter and he bought a little Bluetooth and it was easier for him to take calls with his phone in his pocket and just touch that right there, so he wore this Bluetooth all the time. And this Bluetooth is connected to his phone via what? Radiation waves, and so it's on all the time. Let me show you.
The manufacturers actually tell people in the instruction manual, which I've never read, not to put the cell phone against your ear.
Yeah, you know, that was pretty surprising to us as well. We came upon that particular fact a little bit into the investigation. We had been talking to the safety experts, talking to people who are dealing with cell phone safety quite a bit. And then when you read the actual insert that people never read, frankly, that comes with the phone, it does say exactly that. There's the BlackBerry, for example, warns to keep your phone at least 0.98 inches away from the body when transmitting, and the iPhone 4 gives a similar warning as well. It's tough to do, obviously. What is interesting here, Anderson, if you dig a little bit deeper into this, what you find is that there is a certain amount of radiation that is considered the FCC limit. But that limit is sort of dictated by having the phone about an inch away from your head. If you move it closer to your head, they say they can no longer guarantee that your phone isn't emitting more radiation than the FCC limit, which is just stunning to me. So all those limits are only based on literally, having your phone a certain distance away from your head.
What does that mean? That means if you look at your owner's manual for your phone, it says never touch your phone to what? Your ear. Have you ever seen anybody making a phone call like this, unless it's on speakerphone? That everybody does. Now watch, what that does is it does this. It actually, now this is just where you get it from, it actually heats your tissue because it's like microwaves, but it's not like a frequency like a microwave, but it actually heats the tissue, and you can actually do tests where you can see people's brain tissue heated all the way to the middle. And guess who's the most susceptible? Children. They're up to 3 to 5 times more acceptable than adults because their tissues are softer and there's more liquid, and so they heat faster. Does that make sense? So what you see is, this is a thermography. We have a thermography unit, right? This is a video thermography where they took a human being and they had a picture first, then they did a 15-minute phone call on his cell phone, and then they did another one. Guess what you see? This is like taking your head and putting it in halfway in a microwave oven and turning it on. Now, if you did that every day, would you be surprised if you had brain cancer or a parotid tumor? No, you'd be, well, I knew it was going to happen eventually. But what you didn't think about is that your phone is cooking you every day. And listen, it was a wake-up call. Why am I talking about this? Let's get into nutrition. I'm talking because this is about lifestyle. I want you to have a lifestyle that's successful. Raise your hand if you're on your phone at least a couple times a day anyway. Anybody? Everybody, no, yes, thank you.
Texting,
right, texting, whatever else. Yeah, Mario back there, living on your phone. But watch this. There are solutions. Let me be very clear. There's solutions. Actually, I got a lot of the solutions from Scott and Tracy. Scott's the one that had the surgery. Actually, this is his surgery right here.
Oh, wow.
Right there. And this is one of mine. This is like my brother here. I love them. I can't believe this happened. And you know what? I missed it. I just feel like, man, and this is why they call it practice, just to be quite honest. But I wish I'd have known this to keep him from having to go through that. And I feel very guilty about it. But I can tell you this, everybody watching this film and everybody here, I'm telling you now, so if it comes up, it doesn't have to happen to you, but guess who's responsible if it does? You are. Right, which means you can do something now to fix it. How do we fix it? Okay, a couple things you can do. Now listen, I don't want to get too fruity and way off track. I'm already an alternative doctor, but there's some things that are really fruity and crazy. Energy fields and chakras and things like this, yes?
Does that mean also laptops too?
Laptops too, okay. Yeah, on your lap. And the Bluetooth around your neck, yes. Yeah, those are well. And so, what are some solutions? First of all, we don't want to just work on your phones and your laptops first. Most people will start with trying to figure out how to do that, the solutions for your devices. But you don't start with device solutions first. You start with personal protection first, okay? And again, I don't want to get too way fruity and way, but there's something to it. Would you agree? All right, so, and again, I've done all the research. I could get extremely scientific and show you. I mean, like, if you take an electric wire and you put electricity through it, it puts off radiation. Yes, like electromagnetic radiation. That's why we're talking about this. Well, the brain emits what? Electricity. It's electricity. It goes down your spinal cord, which is basically like a big wire, and it goes out wires that your nerves. So taking electricity up and down creates what? It creates its own field of magnetic or electromagnetic a field. Does it make sense? Some people call that an aura or whatever else. Again, we start talking about centers in the body where there's a higher resonance of those things as well. You can also start looking at how the polarity works, and in the body it actually is more left to right. And again, I know it's some weird stuff and whatever else. I got it. I don't want to get too far into that because I'm already the quack anyways, but listen, there's something that we've come across, okay, and it's these. It's what this is right here. It's called an energy polarity product, and it's created by a polymer. And again, I don't want to get too terribly technical. Please just listen to me, believe me, maybe do your own research. But you put this thing like this, because it actually has its own polarity too, and you put it on your left side, not your right side, so that it balances out. And what you're using this for is you're using it to, imagine if you had 7 violins and they're all either a little bit high or a little bit low as far as their tuning, right? So a little sharp or a little flat, and everybody started to play, what would it sound like? Like, no, right? But this is basically the tuning. So it basically tunes all your frequencies so that you have something more like this instead of like this. So when you're actually putting off a very strong aura, if you will, or just your own frequency, it basically makes most of the electromagnetic frequency bounce off of you. So listen, I want to sell you a bunch of stuff for your phones and your laptops and everything else, but don't waste your money. Start with this thing. Got it? Okay, this is called Cook's diode. Basically, it was something that came up in the 60s. It actually really does work. It may or may not be on there. I don't have that. Slim diode right there. So that's what these are, slim diodes. Okay, now I may only have, listen to me, look at me. I may only have like 10 of these in the house. If you want them, great. If you don't have them, they can order them. They'll be here within the week. Okay, so you can always get a rain check on them. Okay, now wait, what's next? What next is get that phone where it's not sizzling your tissue, so you can actually, even though you're wearing this thing, protect yourself even more. Scott and Tracy turned me on to this company here. They actually won awards across the world for their design. It's called Safe Sleeve. You start buying stuff like this slim diode and things, and you basically have to take people's word for it unless you do your own research and all the rest, right? Because you can't see these EMFs. You don't know if they're, like if I put it on my phone, does it really keep the EMFs coming out? Right, you don't know. But they actually went to the FCC lab and that where they have million-dollar machines where they read frequencies, and guess what? They found that these block 99% of EMF, EMR radiation coming off your phone or your laptop. And this is a sleeve, so what you actually do is you put your laptop folded up in there, and then when you're ready to use it, you take it out, fold it, and you set it on that sleeve, and it doesn't what? Emit radiation down. I would even use it on the table because those go right through the tables too, right? Also, they've got it for your phones, every type of phone, whether it's Samsung or it's whatever. I don't even know if they have Blackberries anymore, but iPhones and different types of iPhones, and it doubles as a wallet. Got it? Make sense?
Blackberry.
The Blackberry. Good. There it is. There it is. So they do still have it. But the point is, they have them for all of them. Got it? Okay. So just go to safesleevecases.com. Safesleevecases.com. Got it? I think the phone covers are like $29 to $39. Got it? I'll have it to you. I ordered mine yesterday. Ours will be here Wednesday. I was hoping to be able to show you guys, but I couldn't. Let's go into some food. Right now, what you need to know is there are 160,000 food additives right now. The average person consumes 150 pounds of damaging, poisonous food additives per year. 150 pounds. Can you imagine that? 150, that's a lot. 150, the average person. And if you're a child, you're more susceptible. You see a problem with that, right? Now, I'm gonna get into some of those, but there's a free app, since we're talking about phones, don't burn yourself out just by trying to find it, but there's a free app called Dirty Dozen. If you're taking notes, write it down. It's called Dirty Dozen, it's a free app, and you will find this, okay? What it means is there's certain things that you wanna choose organic, and there's certain things that you don't necessarily have to choose organic, okay? The reason that you wanna choose organic for these is because these are the highest pesticide rates that you will ever get in your produce, and you need to buy these organic if it's possible. Okay, does it make sense?
Yes.
Pesticides. In 2013, the FDA did research, and they found there was 160,000 different produce items, and out of 100, but actually there was the types, there was 3,100 different types of produce, and guess what they found? Over two-thirds were actually fully contaminated with pesticides. What does that mean? You gotta choose wisely. Right? And listen, you would not have somebody dressed like this spraying that stuff and consider it safe. Right? But guess what the FDA does? They said it's just fine. Just fine. It's completely safe. And listen, but here's the thing. The same pesticide that they use there is a lot like the same thing they use at your house. Who has a pest company come once a year and they spray for bugs once a year? Okay, a lot of people do. Well, guess what? If you live in an apartment, you don't know it's happening, but it happens. We had a family that was here was several years ago. She was pregnant. She didn't realize. She came home. She smelt a little something. They had sprayed for roaches, you know. And guess what? She went into labor. She was very early on. She lost the baby. There's some sad stuff that happens. Pesticides are poison. And you exposed to it. Actually, you know what? Metabolics. Raise your hand if you've done metabolics here. So about half of you guys, we've had people whose metabolics completely cleared, and then they went back, they did the metabolics again, and everything was clear, but they blew out off the charts on some cancer-causing stuff and a couple of their metabolic profiles, and guess what it was? They got their house sprayed, and they were exposed to that. And so we want to eliminate it at your house. We also want to eliminate it in your food. Got it? Easy to do, okay? Now, if you want to put your money into something, if you had to choose between organic produce or organic meat, guess which one you pick?
Meat.
Organic meat, because your money is in the meat. You want to spend it. It takes 8 pounds of chemically sprayed grain to make 1 pound of beef. Now, let's talk about this for a second. The reason that conventional beef is bad is three reasons: a corn diet, antibiotics, and hormones. And the reason is that is this. 75 years ago, almost every single cow was pasture raised. Yes or no?
Yes.
Every single one. And very few were feedlot raised. Now it's what? Completely opposite. You can't really find any that are completely pasture raised. They're mostly are feedlot. Let me tell you how this works. We used to butcher cows. Anybody from a farm family? Anybody? When we butchered cows, they used to be what? 4 or 5 years old average. Okay? That's how old cows were. Unless they're feeder calves. Watch this. Now, if they're feeder calves or they're feedlot calves, what that means is we start a cow off. Cows are generally born about 80 pounds, okay? We put them out to pasture. All cows are started out in pastures, generally. And then at some point in time, very soon after that, they're made into feedlot calves or young cows. And basically, instead of 4 to 5 years of age, now you can raise the same cow up to 1,200 pounds, the same as a 4 or 5 year old cow, in about 14 months. So we butcher most cows between 14 and 16 months instead of 4 or 5 years. So you can, how do you do that? Here's the thing, you actually feed them corn. If I fed you corn, guess what happened to you? You get really big, right? Do you know, watch this, do you know that cows are not supposed to eat corn? Would you agree? They're supposed to eat grass. Do you know that if you actually just take a cow that's eating grass and immediately don't let them have grass, just eat corn, they die. You can't switch a cow over instantly. You have to do it gradually. Did you know that? And you cannot actually feed a cow just corn and they survive it. Guess what? You also have to feed them mass quantities of what? Antibiotics. Mass quantities of antibiotics. And at the same time, you can't get all this to happen without feeding them also hormones. So when you get a feedlot cow, you get hormones, antibiotics. Watch this. How much antibiotics does it take to keep a cow alive before you butcher them? Well, guess what? The United States feedlot cows consume, and other like chickens, it's United States basically agriculture, consumes 85% of the world's antibiotics just in the United States. Do you see why it's important to eat organic food or meat? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Right. So, again, you don't want that. Right? I thought that was a very cool picture. Yeah. Just enjoy that for a second because it took me a while. It was really cool. There you go. Let me enjoy it. Yeah. A bunch of druggy cows equals druggy meat. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. And come with hormones. Which, by the way, did you know that if you get a glass of like just milk, that it has over 160 different antibiotic residues in it?
Wow.
Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
So if you like these kids are like the, all the school system, make sure these kids get milk.
Uh-huh.
Guess what they're getting? 160 different residues of antibiotics, which if you give a cow a bunch of corn antibiotics, guess what happens to them? They get big. You give a human corn and antibiotics, guess what happens to them? They get what? They get big. Exactly. So there's an epidemic. How about fish? Let's eat fish. If you looked at this on a plate, and one was from conventionally farmed, and one was from, you know, wild, would you be able to tell the difference? And guess what the answer is? You would not. You have to ask. The reason for it is because conventionally farm-raised, guess what they feed them? Bunch of crap. They feed them actually fish meal, which is what? It's corn and dead fish and hormones. So that makes them into cannibals. You think that changes DNA, and that's why they have tumors, and then the fish die, and they just turn them into fish meal for the ones that survive, and they keep giving it to them, right? But you know, actually, Sam's had a whole thing that actually failed. I think it was Sam's or one of the big Costco's or something. They actually had farm-raised salmons, and the farm-raised salmon came back, and it was all just like nasty, brown-looking meat, and they couldn't sell it. They said, nobody wants this, and they lost I don't know how much money they lost. So guess what the farms did? They put color in the fish meal that made, and they had to tweak it a little bit because some was a little too pink, some was a little more orangey, and they had to make it just right. And so now they actually feed the fish color that actually colors their muscle flesh an exact color of a wild salmon. So you cannot tell the difference. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Lifestyle. Everybody say lifestyle.
Lifestyle.
Just lifestyle. You got to ask. Now, how do you know? How do you get this stuff out of you? Like if you are actually not doing something consciously to get your toxins not just to come out of the cell, but to be bound and removed out of the cell, it'd be like this. It'd be like you, anybody had a fish tank any time in your life with fish? It'd be like you cleaning the fish tank, taking all the gook in it like this, and then just dumping it back in the fish tank. That's what it's like every time that you do some kind of something to cleanse yourself or whatever else, and you don't do it by binding everything else that comes out. Got it? It's like clean the fish tank and then take it and just go bloop, and you drop it right back in the water. That's what that means. This is what has to happen. You have to, number one, remove the source. That's why I'm saying we want to buy the right stuff. We want to take the right stuff. We want to get the phone away from you. We want to, you know, not have you getting flu shots. We want to have you decrease your medications, getting out of the pesticides. Remove the source. But then we want to what? We want to cleanse the body by bringing oxygen, nerve supply, and phytonutrients in so you're getting the right stuff, right? And then we want to bind the toxins that are coming out for safe removal. Otherwise, your body will retox as it uses bile and stuff again when you do 85% of your detox at night. Make sense? How do we do that? Very simple. We give the cell what it needs. How does an unhealthy cell become healthy? We change the cell membrane. Everybody say membrane.
Membrane.
It's the gates. Everybody say gates.
Gates.
Right? How does that work? It just works by, come here. If she's a cell and I am a, if I'm like a plastic wrap, so you guys have seen me do this in the past, and I just surround her with plastic wrap, then she can't breathe. Could you see that? Right? Right? I wouldn't do that. But what happens is, if she's a cell, nothing good can get what?
In.
And nothing bad can get what?
Out.
And as a result of that, this becomes an unhealthy cell. We start to get auto-intoxication, replication with inside the cell, RNA and DNA, transcriptase, it doesn't work right, so we have abnormal cellular replication, which is called what eventually? Cancer, right? And so an unhealthy cell needs a good cell membrane so I can get good stuff and bad stuff out. And how do you do that? Good. You give it what it needs to get every one of these systems working the way that it should. How do we do that? Very simple. It took us 12 years to get it, but we have this. It's body detox and cell detox. Cell is what allows the cell membrane to be permeable to toxins again. It helps the cell membrane, okay? Body is what you take at night so that when your stuff is coming out of your liver, which is what happens, 85% of it comes out of the liver, it basically binds everything up. Got it?
Got it.
Very simple, very easy to do. Now everybody take a deep breath in. All the way out. Now listen, I've had a lot of people over the last 20 years who've gone through some bad things. Someone dies, someone lost their job, someone's going through a divorce, someone has something going on, and inevitably they're stressed. And guess how people breathe when they're stressed? Yeah. That doesn't look like they're breathing sometimes. Right? Can you tell I'm breathing?
No.
Breathing is just shallow. Have you ever been in a haunted house or been in the dark and you were so scared that you were trying to listen to everything?
Yeah.
Right? You were so scared, right? Guess how you breathe? No, it was shallow because you were trying to listen. Now, if you're breathing like that, you don't even know it. Can you see how you could keep a lot of things bad going on internally in your ability to handle stress? Mm-hmm. I think some of you guys need to, on your phones, which are not going to be safe hopefully in the future, I think you need to set an alarm on that every 15, 20 minutes. So it has an alarm, just kind of beeps for a second, and it reminds you to do what? If you did that, do you know what the research actually shows us? Do you know what happens to your stress hormones? They go down. Guess what happens to your good hormones? They go up. Guess what happens to your body's ability to lose weight even? Just from breathing? Yeah, it does. I mean, I'm gonna get a little fruity this talk, but it's lifestyle. Everybody say lifestyle.
Lifestyle.
Right? Just relax. God got you to this point. He's gonna get you to the next point. It's gonna be fine, right? I could, listen, if you don't know Jesus, we may have an altar call on that one tonight too, but the problem with it is, guess what? It's just, some people just stay so stressed. They don't have mechanisms in their life to deal with it. So, now here's the other thing. Why is oxygen so important? Hold your breath long enough. Guess what? You have to have it. Listen, it's the one thing that is a supplement that you have to get constantly, and most of you don't get enough of. So this morning I did a workout, and by the way, it was my first 4:30 workout. I was working out early, but I wasn't working out that early. And time change and go work out early. So this morning I worked out. And Monday workouts are always some of the worst because I know you had the weekend to kind of recover. You know what I'm talking about? So I get in there and it's thrusters and sprints today. And I got done 15 minutes of as fast as I could possibly go, as hard as I possibly could go. And when I got done, I couldn't stand up. I fell on my back and went like this. And when I got up, it looked like a sweat angel. It was like this, and my brain like that. But I say all this to say, Guess what I was doing to the deepest tissues in my body this morning? I was driving oxygen. Guess what I was doing to cancer? I was killing it. Guess what I was doing to my metabolic processes everywhere? Now, some of you guys go to the gym and you do get workouts in, but you don't do that. And you go there and you've all, I kind of make fun sometimes, but you get on a treadmill and it's like you're reading a book and you're like, right there. Or you're watching something on your phone, right? And you're watching something, you're like, hey, this is awesome, right? And you did your hour, right? You did your hour and you went home, you're like, whew, man, this is nice. This is so good. I got a little bit moist, right? I'm 8 minutes in and I bent over to grab the bar and I had like 4 drops of sweat come off at one time. I thought I'm gonna have to mop this up because I am showering my sweat onto the, like, but guess what? That's my lifestyle. And listen, not everybody here has to do CrossFit or something like this, but I want you to have your lifestyle that regularly drives your oxygen pathways like that. Does it make sense? And most people don't do that anymore, okay? And you need to do that, okay? How do you do that? It's not hard, just exercise. And it needs to be hardcore exercise sometimes. Now, I started doing CrossFit only, I was doing it 5 days a week, now I do it Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and now I still do some cardio because I want to do a long run or like a half marathon or something later this year. And so I'm doing an hour or longer cardio on Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday. And now I just do CrossFit 3 days a week. So I'm blowing past O2 saturations those days. But what's it do? It increases glutathione, strengthens the immune system, detoxification system. Do you think I'm detoxing at 5 a.m. in the morning?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right? In fact, smell my sweat. You'd be like, oh yeah, he's detoxing. Right? This is the thing that you have at home that's still in the wrapper, the cellophane wrapper. Yeah, see there? Yeah. So maybe just open it for some of you guys that haven't opened that just yet. You're laughing, but it's good. It is the easiest thing. You put it in the DVD player, hit play, and 12 minutes later, you're done. Okay, and it will get you out of breath, yes or no? It is great. Okay, so start it. It's really, really good. Okay, now, what is this thing? So you guys are here for the hyperbaric workshop?
Yeah.
Hyperbaric is the newest, coolest thing, and it's actually not new. 1662 is when, up to 1937, it got better and better and better, up until the point that this guy Cunningham made this thing. It's 7 stories, 72-room hyperbaric hotel. Or hospital, if you will. They call it a sanitarium. And people would go in here, it stayed with pressurized all the time. You went in here, and you went through pressure and more pressure, and then you went to this one and pressurized, and then you went in, okay? And you stayed in there, you went in with disease, and you came out without disease. Diabetes, depression, wounds, everything. It was just crazy until the AMA got word of it, 1937, and guess what the AMA did? They slandered him. They came up with a bunch of false accusations. They ruined his name. They ran him broke. And then when he was broke, and basically killed him, they bought this thing, and so that it wouldn't still be around and people would know about it, they actually used cutting torches and they cut it up and sold it for scrap metal. But it has had a resurgence because you can't keep the truth down, right? The truth's always going to surface somewhere. And so the problem with it is most people can't do hyperbaric because it's so expensive. Like just the hyperbaric unit we have is in the $20,000-something. But if you buy one of the big metal ones, it's $80 to $120. And so you buy one of those things, anybody in town buys that, they're going to charge $300 to $500 an hour for... some of you guys have done it, right? We've talked. Well, because we've had so many cancers, some of you guys have had your own family come here with cancer. If I know something that will help a person with cancer out, and I don't have it here, I have to get it or send you somewhere. Like I can't live in a world where you don't get what you need. And so guess what we started doing about a year ago? We've got to figure it out. So I'm not the most flamboyant person in spending money, and that was a big chunk to do. And so we went in and bought the bullet on that one, and guess what? We did it so that you could do it here and not spend the same money you would other places. It'd be cheaper to do it. Got it? That's why we did it. It's still not the cheapest thing in the world. It's probably not for everybody, but especially for those people who have had issues, you're right in the middle of a healing crisis or a diagnosis, this is for you. Got it? It's also a great way to blast into having a mass amount of oxygen. The reason it works is, this is it right here. The reason it works is Henry's laws of physics. I'm going to go fast through this, but just you don't have to remember physics from a long time ago. But what it means is if you take oxygen under pressure, oxygen becomes a liquid. It dissolves into liquid. So what happens is for right now, for you to get oxygen, it has to travel inside of what? Red blood cells. Everybody remember that? So when your red cell, when you take a deep breath, your red blood cells get oxygen, and then they go through the body, and as they go through, they lose oxygen molecules from each, because there's one oxygen molecule per red blood cell, and then when it gets taken off, it's done, and so you'll have red blood cells without oxygen going down. Diabetics, very classic, they don't have any more oxygen in the red blood cells at the end, so their feet and their toes die, right? The only way you can get oxygen is from your red blood cells, but when you're in a hyperbaric chamber, oxygen is in all the liquid. So everything that's liquid in your body can be used to transport oxygen. So your blood plasma has oxygen in it. Your saliva has oxygen. Your cerebral spinal fluid, your disc fluid, everything in it, it is now carrying its own oxygen levels because it can put oxygen in it. Does it make sense? So you have oxygen everywhere in your body when you do a hyperbaric chamber. You see people that cannot heal, like people with huge ulcers and stuff on their feet, diabetic ulcers and stuff. They just can't get oxygen down there. They put them in oxygen chambers, and guess what? Closes up, heals up completely. We've had people, amazing research already, just the people that some of you guys have started already, amazing. What's it look like? Well, you're in there for about 60 minutes. Average person's in about an hour. David, I think you guys have done it already, haven't you? Yeah, so it's not bad. Some of you guys have fears of being in like a small place. It's not that bad. Watch movies. You can, hopefully not, have a laptop buzzing like a microwave in there with you, but we're gonna help you do something hopefully safe with that. But read books, whatever else, and it's over real fast, right? And it's not bad. It doesn't feel like you're, like someone's pressing on you. Like you can't, once you're pressurized in there, you can't tell it's even pressure, right? Like you just have to go through like popping your ears basically on an airplane. Now, classic. I have to hit on this. It's lifestyle. I want to be very clear. When you lay on that table in there, do you lay on there because you have a problem or do you lay in there because it's your lifestyle? Don't answer. Do you lay in there and get adjusted because you have a problem, or do you lay in there because it's your lifestyle? And the reason I bring that up is, let's say that the economy completely crashed, okay, and in Jesus' name it's not gonna happen. Whatever. If it happens, what are your non-negotiables? I know my non-negotiables, I want clean food, clean water, place to stay, my kids being safe, and all of us get adjusted. Some people would actually take your adjustments off the table, like, well, I just can't afford that anymore. To that I would say, well, then it probably wasn't implemented into your lifestyle to begin with. You were here for your problem. Does it make sense? This is either part of your lifestyle or it's not, right? I would say if it's not part of your lifestyle, you should stop. Save your money. Because if you stop in a year and then go 5-10 years from now, guess what it'll be like? You're starting over, your spine rotted on you, everything else. This should be your lifestyle. Guess what you see after 20 years, the people that have been under care and keep getting adjusted regularly for 20 years, guess what they're like compared to their friends? It is a freakish difference. Like one is not aging, one is leaner. Paula and Ron have been patients for years and years and years, decade now or something like this. They started out, they did a makeover with us. That's how they came into the office. They did 3 makeovers. They did a month-long makeover. You know how we do a makeover? They got done with the first month and they just start over again. And then we got the second month, they just start over. They did 3 months in a row of doing the same makeover and got amazing results, off their meds, lost weight. Well, they've kind of had another renaissance with their care. It got started, did all their stuff. They did their makeover. They did metabolics. Some of you guys have not done metabolics, had amazing results with metabolics. And it's got them fired up again. He's down to his high school weight, right? In his 60s. I mean, he's killing it in his workouts. So is she, doing amazing. But you look around them, that everybody that's their age, they're people that aren't here anymore, that died. They're people that are barely, they're just getting around, they're barely going. My mom is a great example of lifestyle. My mom gets adjusted. She sent me a text this morning. My mom, she's 74, I almost said 75 this morning. Just don't ever tell her I said, almost said 75. She's 74. But she ran 5 miles this morning in the cold, right? And she's doing 25 to 30 miles a week. Not walking. I'm not talking about she went out to walk. She went out to run. Wow. Did you get that?
Yeah.
And I don't know that I could do that right now. And I was like, man, that's awesome. But you know why she does that? She's freakish. Who does that at 74? Do you know why she does that? She does that because she wants to be able to feel good and be able to do stuff that nobody else, not that she wants to be able to be better than or whatever else. She just likes to be able to go and do. And she feels great all the time. But you know what? When all her friends go out and they have coffee and they get a little cheesecake and they get a little honey bun, whatever else, guess what she gets? Tea. That's what she has, right? Lifestyle. Can everybody say lifestyle?
Lifestyle.
Lifestyle. Good. But it starts with a nervous supply. This is the thing we have to check. If you've done, if it's not about checking this and keeping this, then you are in the wrong place. But again, it's very simple. This is misalignment of the atlas. I did so much research. Everybody take your finger like this. Put your finger up like this. Everybody like this. Now take it, and I want you to feel the bottom of your skull behind your ear. Feel that? Now just go down where it sucks back down a little bit, where it's more like muscly right there. Now press in on that. Just right underneath that bone. Okay, just the tip of that bone right there. You see that? Tip of that bone? Now go right down below that. Guess what the tip of that is right there? That's your atlas, or the first bone, the lateral mass. That's what that is right there. Everybody feel that? If this is even askewed within millimeters, it does any of these things plus about 100 other ones. And all of these, Nobel Prize is won for this, okay? If that is off, you're pressing yours, don't press yours too hard. That was actually her issue right there. But this is a great picture. I've never shown this picture ever to this family here. This is a good picture, okay? So what happens is the brain, okay, reads signals from the body. And everybody thinks it's a one-way street. Like, everybody thinks about the brain controlling tissue, right? So if I choke it off, it can't get there now that the organ dies. But it's a two-way street, okay? What happens is the brain that runs everything can give the body what it needs in accordance to what it's asking for, and it knows what it's asking for because the signal's 100% in and out. Does it make sense?
Yep.
But now this is the first bone that you just had your finger on. Now just misalign that. Rotation, angulation, whatever it is, we call that subluxation. Now you do this. Now I choke off the message coming in. When you were kids, did you have the little can with a string on it? And you went, hey, what's going over there? Can you hear what I'm talking about? But it sounded, when you had that can, it sounded like this. But you heard some words, so you kind of got the idea what the conversation was about. Well, if I choke off your spinal cord with a subluxation, then I can hear, like you can tell your stomach is eating something and it needs to get the acid up, but then it can't tell what it should be. Like, if you eat a steak and an apple at different times, your pH in your stomach should be different, should it not? Why? Because the stomach said, hey, I have a steak in it, and your brain goes, oh, I know what the acid should be, and then it tells it what to do. And when it's an apple, it goes, oh, I know what the acid should be for an apple, and it puts it in there. But now when you hear, oh, this, guess what? It maybe the pH is wrong, right? And now it starts bubbling up. What do you call that? Yeah, but guess what? You call it acid reflux because you've been marketed to, and now it has a label, and now you can say, I have this label.
Yeah.
Now, do this, choke off the nerve supply, cause a change in carotid sinus, which controls blood pressure, right? Now your blood pressure goes up. We call this, this is a label, hypertension. Now you know this subluxation type only by its outcome, and now you say, well, I have hypertension. You don't have hypertension, you don't have acid reflux. You know what you have? You've got a misaligned spine that nobody ever checked, and they've been drugging you ever since for it, right? Or blaming your genetics or your age or something else. Does it make sense? Can you see why people that might have, and watch this, how many antidepressants does it take to fix that? How many acid reflux pills does it take to fix that, right? Or blood pressure medication, or cholesterol drugs. You cannot fix it with that. Guess what the only thing you can do? Move it back, fix it. It's interesting, you know, doctor, we have to do continuing ed constantly. Doctor, I'm throwing her under the bus a little bit, hope she doesn't mind. But she went for like 8 to 8 on Saturday and 8 to 1 on Sunday this last weekend. And she was in there with a bunch of other chiropractors. And the person leading this, along with the other chiropractors, was like, how do you talk to your patients about chiropractic? Because I hear about these people that have like dinners. They go out and they have like free dinners. And they go out and they tell people how, that if you've got your spine misaligned, that it causes organs to shut down and whatever else. And you can't tell people that. It's only musculoskeletal. And you wonder why the whole world is bought into medicine. It's because the one population of people that should be telling the truth have been trained at chiropractic school that this is not the case. And guess what? I've seen, 27,000 people in almost 20 years, and guess what the truth is? When you have a spine that's subluxated and you fix it, guess what happens to your organs? I am living proof.
Yeah.
My heart was dying. I was supposed to have heart surgery or die. You fix my neck, and guess what happens to an irreversible heart condition? It's gone. Don't you tell me I can't tell a patient that. I lived it. I don't need a double-blind study. And guess what? I just had, before I left for vacation, someone who couldn't get pregnant, now they're pregnant because their female organs work. I mean, come on. Don't listen. The fact that a chiropractor, another chiropractor, not to tell their patients that should be criminal. Someone should be going to jail. Right? So, and next time you hear something about chiropractic not being scientific or hokey pokey, or you, I don't know about organs and stuff and whatever, they say they can cure cancer or whatever else. I would never say I can cure anything. Do you know why? Because I don't cure anything. Do you know who cures it?
Jesus.
Well, you say Jesus too. I actually, that's the trump card. But your body does. Your body is, he made the bodies. Okay. Someone says, Jesus, like, I got nothing. I got nothing. But the point is, I don't heal anything, you do. Make sense? Right? So anyway, I digress. Okay, now let's go back to this. Cruciferous. Everybody say cruciferous.
Cruciferous.
I had my test come back. They made me drink over a liter of broccoli juice, freshly squeezed broccoli juice, a day for a week. And it was 9 huge heads of broccoli to make 1 liter.
Oh, wow.
And I was drinking that every single 9 of those at one time. A liter every day. The reason that was is because my glutathione had gone down, and I just, listen, it's hard work adjusting a couple hundred people a day, and it's stressful, and I love you guys, and it's just, it's hard on me sometimes. And so I really had issues with my health. And so I did the tests, and it's like a lot of like metabolics, and he came back, he told me to drink broccoli juice. It was one of my things, and then take 29 pills a day or whatever it was. But this is it. This is one of them, okay? But the reason is because the things that you do during your day drop your body's glutathione levels, right? And your mom said, eat what?
Broccoli,
but also, you know, garlic, onions, kale, collard greens, cauliflower, watercress, all these things that actually produce it, right? Now, let me ask you a question. How much more broccoli do you think you need to eat now compared to what it was? Do you see where I'm going? Right? Can you see why it took a liter of a day for that to actually get any big changes? Who would like to eat 9 stalks of broccoli a day? I'm not talking about the little, I'm not talking about one like this. I'm talking about, okay? I got one taker right there. Yes! A broccoli man. Me too, bro. Lots of butter.
With butter, salt.
Salt. Yes, bring it. But it would be hard to eat all that. Here's the problem. Listen to me. There's the problem. You can't do it. Which is why lifestyle, how do we make a lifestyle successful? You should you not, should you eat this?
Yes.
Yes, do not stop. You should eat this. But we can't do all that we should all the time. So what do? We got to get away from this. So we got to reduce the source. So let's work on our stress. Let's make sure we get adjusted so everything works right. But we also want to make sure that we're getting as much of this as we can. This is the only reason I came up with this. I do not want to sell products. I feel like a guy on the, you know, it's like the call now and get whatever and a Ginsu Nice or something like that. I hate it. But guess what? I'm going to sell you on it because you have to have it to be healthy. And, you know, going in there and doing a consult with a guy that's things tore up from all this, other, it's a nightmare for me. You guys are like family. And if you don't get what you need, I did not do what I was supposed to do. Does it make sense? And so this is a very easy way to get it. This is my wife's favorite things right now. It's Max Greens. Who's tried the Max Greens before? Anybody? Yeah, so like half the room. Love Max Greens. If you've not tried it, make sure you get it. Also, something that we're really big on is lemon water. Some of you guys have tried my water. If you ever look at this, this water is actually not just water. It's the water from the front, but I've got lemon essential oil. Now, you can just take lemons and just put that in there, but a lemon essential oil is good for consumption. So you can do lemon. I also do tangerine. I also do lime. Sometimes I put 2 drops of lemon and 1 drop of lime in there. You know who I got that from?
Yeah?
Yeah, that's right. But Regina gave it to me for my gift, for my birthday. But anyway, so that's what we do. Now watch. Water is very important. It's a lifestyle. I drink at least 3 of these a day, okay? These are, I forget how many ounces this is, 26 ounces, right? So imagine. Now, it seems like a lot, but when I'm sweating in here, that's why it's so cold in here all the time, because I've got to drink a lot of water. You should drink at least 26 to 42 ounces of water a day, depending on your size, depending on your athletic level, right? And then the time of the year, if it's hot outside. Does that make sense? Now, why lemon water? Lemon water is good for your pH. It also helps detoxification. It helps with sleeping. It actually helps you sleep a little better. It helps with... when I said detox method, digestion, it's actually helped with it as well. There's actually studies that even show that it actually reduces fevers for kids who are having some fever stuff. Not that we want to give you something to reduce a fever, but it helps the body. So, but lemon, it's also really, really good. So I'm going to go through a 21-day reset. This is part of it. Got it? Now, you can just do water. You don't have to do lemon water. But I like lemon water because it's refreshing, okay? And it tastes better. The difference between diet and cleansing, I threw this in there because you better know it. I do not want anybody to go on a diet. You go, three-fourths of the word is die. Nobody wants to die it, right?
Yeah, that's true.
The problem with dieting is the reason that there's a rebound effect is because fat stores what? Your toxins. And when you just go diet and try to starve yourself or eat just nothing but, you know, three celery sticks a day or something like this, what ends up happening, or just do like, what was it, the lemon water and cayenne or whatever, the sugar, whatever, remember that one? Yeah, I tried that one too. The reason that happens is because you actually diet. Your body actually releases toxins from fat cells, and then you may lose a little weight, but now the toxicity is, you're up to your back teeth in toxicity, so now you're actually more unhealthy. So then guess what happens? You actually mess up your metabolic processes, and then guess what happens soon after? You get heavy again. The reason that detox and cleansing is part of our lifestyle is because it's something that's needed. And every single spring, guess what? Herbs are going to do it. Guess what I know is going to happen before the end of May? Mm-hmm. Every single year, sometime, it's already planned in. I won't tell you that I'm smart enough to do it. My wife is the reason I'm so healthy, is we're going to do another liver gallbladder flush, right? Some of you guys have seen me talk about that before. I'm not going to flush my gallbladder because I'm trying to save my gallbladder and they want to take it out because I got a bunch of stones. I'm going to flush my gallbladder because it's time to flush my gallbladder again. I do it every spring, right? And it's just a cleanse. That's what we do. I'm going to do this cleanse with you guys. It's a 21-day cleanse. I'm going to do it too. It's like January. I'd already done a month of a makeover before I had you do it. Why did I do that? Because I'm going to not ever tell you to do something that I'm not doing, and it's because it's part of my lifestyle. Listen, if you go to a doctor who's 350 pounds and smokes and is eating a piece of fried chicken, don't take health advice from him. Right? Right? Lifestyle. That's all I'm saying. Lifestyle. Now, this is it. Now, this is the 20-day. I'm almost done. We're done here. So this is the 21-day reset, okay? Spring, the 21-day spring reset. I mean, this thing has got recipes. It's got all kind of stuff in it. I mean, this is probably the greatest 21-day. It's not like a challenge, but it's kind of like a challenge. But it's the best, I think, that Maximize Living ever put together. And I want you guys to have this. It's so many pages. If I printed this off, I would have printed like a box of paper or something. I didn't know how many to do. So what I did is I did a digital download of it on the website and a digital download on Facebook. So I want you to do this. If you have your phone, you got Facebook, go on Facebook, like us right now, and then you'll be able to find it. Got it? So Herb Family Wellness Center, you'll find us. Or you can go on to herbfamilywellness.com and go to New Patient Paperwork, and this is in the downloads on New Patient Paperwork. Okay, so 21-day spring reset. Got it? Okay. You can find it. Now let me explain it a little bit, okay? It's a 21 days, it's 3 weeks. The first week, all of it has foundation principles, okay? So this is what this says. It's basically like advanced plan. So you're gonna do no grains, sugars or starches for 3 weeks. Could we do that? It's not easy if you've been doing it, but we can do it, right? Get organic meat, okay, ideally pasture-raised, and then drink a minimum of half your body weight in water in ounces, okay? That's just the foundation principles, got it? Everybody look at me. This is a cleanse. This is not just like a do the advanced, this is a cleanse, okay? The idea of a cleanse is you take pressure off of your body's workload so it gets a chance to actually do more detox than it has been, okay? So the first week is three healthy meals a day with a smoothie or shake in the a.m. Got it? So you're getting really two meals and a shake or a smoothie in the morning. Got it? And then lots of water. Everybody with me? and then you're doing the advanced plan. Very simple. This prepares your body. So you got 1 week where you're increasing your fluid. Listen, the fluid is what helps you digest food. It helps you detox. It helps the liver. It helps all these things. You're trying to rehydrate yourself. Got it? And you're actually decreasing your inflammation by getting away from a lot of things you shouldn't be eating. That's the first week. Prepares your blood, stabilizes your blood sugar, all that. Phase two, second week, okay? What you're going to do is this begins intermittent fasting, okay? If we're at the makeover in January or into January, February, this is where we actually introduced intermittent fasting the first time, okay? This is what I've been doing. This is how I lost a lot of the weight. You know, I've lost 17 pounds since January 3rd. What you're going to do is you're only going to eat the second week in an 8 to 10 hour eating window. Got it? Okay, most of you guys will, you'll eat a really late breakfast, like at 11, okay? And then you'll eat dinner. Okay, you want to do that during a time you're most relaxed. Okay, my evening time is not the most relaxed. When I go home, I've got a short window of an hour, love my kids, give them a lot of attention, get myself ready. We don't watch TV in the evening times. Get one-on-one with my wife and see what her needs are, what's going on, and then we're in bed, boom. So 9 o'clock, lights are off, everybody's in bed, we're asleep. And it takes a sprint to make that happen. And so evening times are not a good time for me to do this. I eat my meals, this is not for you, I eat breakfast and I eat lunch and a little bit until about 2:30 and then I'm done. So 6:30, 2:30 and I'm done. I don't eat dinner at all. And I've been doing that since January, I'm never going back. Now, most of you guys will actually feel easier if you just skip your breakfast. And I mean skip. You're going to eat a breakfast, but it's going to be later, okay? You're going to drink lots of fluids, okay? The second week, though, breakfast at 11 a.m., finish dinner by 7, okay? Do your best to drink a lot of water. And what you're basically going to do is you're going to drink, in the morning, you're going to drink, guess what? Greens, max greens, okay? So you could do max greens maybe first thing, okay? And then your first, like a smoothie or something at 11 or whatever you're going to do for breakfast. Got it? Okay, and then you eat dinner. Everybody with me? Mm-hmm. Does it make sense? Everybody yes. Tracking? It's not complicated. This is very easy. Don't let the wording fool you or scare you away from it. This is the easiest thing you could do. Third week, you get into third week, and basically you're in a 6 to 8 hour. So you can just do the same 8 hour window, 11 to 7 if you wanted to. First meal at around 12 again. You could just do the 11 to 7 if you want to. Last meal is 7, so again, you could do the same thing. But you're going to increase your hydration. Got it? You want to bump that up a little bit more. Why? This is the third week. You're really into the full bore cleanse. Make sense? You're trying to flush everything out. And again, 2 scoops of max greens. And it says this. You don't have to memorize this. Okay? It's on the sheet that you have. And then only 1 solid food meal. Now, why would you do that? The reason you do that is you want to take the pressure off your digestive system. Got it? So it's only digesting 1 solid meal a day, and the rest of it's liquid, like it's max greens or whatever else, a smoothie, something like this. And then it's very easy digestible. Your body doesn't work very hard on it, and it digests quickly. So you're like right now, if you're eating 3 meals a day and snacks, your body's never getting a break. It's always got something in your stomach. It's always got something in your jejunum and duodenum and colon and all that. It's constantly moving. It's constantly working. That's why spring, and whatever reason, spring's the best time to do a cleanse to give your body a break and actually help to clean itself out. Got it? At the end of this, the lining of your digestive tract will be thicker. It'll be better. It'll be more inoculated. That's why we're doing the pre-probiotics and the FOS, right? Does it make sense? And we're getting everything moving. Got it? Now, did you guys know what this is? This is Natural Grocers down the street.
Yes.
If you've not been there, you need to check it out. This is Steve. Steve's the manager right there. That's what Steve looks like. It's funny. We actually showed up for their grand opening, and the picture didn't turn out for their ribbon cutting. So they said, hey, we need to redo our picture for the ribbon cutting. Do you mind being in the picture? So the only people in the picture is one of the managers, and then this is the mayor of the city, and this is a guy that works there too, and then it's Dr. Joel, Dr. DeBoer, and myself.
Awesome.
And this is what they used nationwide for their ribbon cutting picture, by the way. It's like, so 3/4 of the show is maximized living, like, yes, we did it. So if you haven't been there, go. If I was to own a grocery store, this is the grocery store I'd own, by the way. But this is really cool stuff. That's them. This is Steve right there, by the way. Steve is super nice. Super nice. Stay connected. Max Life webinar. Who would like to be able to do this and be able to stay at home? That's what webinars are. That's what we started doing them. So there's a webinar coming up April 5th, and you just log in. It's right on your computer. The speaker's right there. They can't hear you. You can hear them, and you can be on your couch chilling like this with your laptop with your little thing underneath it so you're not burning yourself up. And then recipe night as well. So we're going to do recipe night, and this whole thing is on lifestyle, all of this. Now, who here knows somebody that needs some help with their lifestyle? Raise your hand if you know somebody that needs some help with their lifestyle. So only the people in the front? So raise your hand if you know somebody that needs help with their lifestyle. So guess what? These are the people I want you to bring to recipe night. These are the people I want you to bring to community dinner or get on the webinar, right? So they don't have to leave their house, right? Anybody have that one friend who you just wish they'd come, but you just feel like they're never going to come like that? If you gave them something where they never have to leave their own home, do you think it might be a little easier? So this is the people that you actually push for the webinar. And those people, you know, they're like, they're just waiting, but they don't want to come to the office. Those people you get to the community dinner. Those people that love free food, anybody that love free food? That's the recipe night, right? So you actually have to know your people. Got it? So be thinking about who you're bringing. Here's the other thing. I want you guys to get this because at the end of the day, why did you show up here? You didn't show up here so your back would feel better. You showed up so your life would get better, right? And I think you saw something in us, Dr. Kimberly and I, and then a lot of people that are here, that you're like, listen, I would like that. And guess what you have to do? You just have to make some simple changes. Now, let me ask you a question. Is it about being perfect?
No.
Do I ever get it perfect? No. Listen, I shot some hogs on vacation, and I ate pork. I haven't had pork in 10 years, and I smoked the ribs the day after we killed these hogs, and they were awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Let me tell you something. Listen, that's unhealthy. I might be going unhealthy once a year with some hog, but that was great. But listen, no one's going to do it perfect. All my kids are having s'mores. Guess what I had? I ended up having a graham cracker because I wanted to be part of the fun. So I had a graham cracker, and I felt a little bit guilty while I was eating it. And I got down, I was like, that was not that good, right? So anyway, but nobody's perfect, right? And so what I'm saying is, I love chocolate. Anybody else love chocolate?
Oh, yeah.
Right? I love chocolate. I have chocolate occasionally. I guess so what I'm saying is, don't try for perfection. Try to make it. Well, I had it today as part of the advanced plan cake for your birthday, which was spectacular. However, the point is, it's literally about not trying to be perfect. It's just trying to make it that's your lifestyle. Mm-hmm. So that this is just how we roll. Mm-hmm. Got it? Yeah. I go on vacation and I exercise. I go on vacation and I still eat right. I go, you know, I have some vacation meal in there, whatever, something fun. But it's just, this is my lifestyle now. And if you live a lifestyle in accordance with what causes your body to be healthy, guess what you will be?
Healthy.
That's the point. Make sense? So I'm going to pray it up. We'll get out of here. Make sure you guys get your products before you go. So if you would bow your heads. Father, we love you and praise you. Thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity to be together. Ask God that you bless every single person. And not just them, but there are such vibrant examples of the amazing health that you've given all of us that every single person in the world that can't help but look at these and go, man, I want that. And so I ask God that you make every single one of these a beacon of hope and light and encouragement to every single person in their homes, in their churches, in their businesses, in their sphere of influences, and because of that, Father, you bring glory to yourself because you bring healing to the world. So, Father, we just love you and praise you. I ask God, this is not just information, but it's revelation, that it's applied and it's application. And, Father, we just love you and praise you and ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.